Peace Party people. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, this is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
And today's special guest is...
I'm Matt Zoe. How's it going?
What's up, man? How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
We're doing great. We got your new album here, Illusion of Depth. And you gave us a list of some of your favorite songs of all time. And then we went and hunted everything down on vinyl. And now we're going to play those tracks and let the record show.
Awesome.
All right, let's do it. All right, Matt, first up on your list, we're going back to 1996 here with Chemical Brothers' Setting Sun. So your picks here, let's put this on. All right, there we go. All right, so Setting Sun, 1996, Chemical Brothers. I mean, totally different approach to the way dance music is made now, but this was so like raw and hard-hitting out the gate with the samples and loops and everything, but... From what I understand, like, this is a pretty influential record for you, just in terms of like how you learn to produce yourself with Logic Pro and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, this track had such a huge influence. I was only what, 6 at the time, but the influence it had on all of dance music at the time, like, it just it was the first time anything this like close to rock, or I mean, besides like Prodigy maybe,
right?
It was like it was a huge moment in dance music where it's like rock and electronic music came together, and yeah, that had a huge influence on me in the later years looking back at this.
At what point did you stumble upon this, and how did it influence you to start doing stuff yourself?
Pretty early on, when I discovered electronic music, like early thousands, I heard this, and even now it's mind-blowing listening back to it. The production is still way beyond a lot of stuff today.
Yeah.
So it's mainly like the detail that in this track, and like all the stuff that you can't really hear that makes this track, you know. It's all the stuff in the background, all the like the little random noises, and
right.
It has so much life and character compared to a lot of stuff now, because it's so like sterile and clean, whereas this wasn't afraid to be dirty. It was awesome.
I always felt this style of production, Chemical Brothers, and you mentioned Prodigy, they always took like almost the Bomb Squad approach from hip hop and applied it. And then you can see the UK influences, and they started singing over it. I've always loved these loops. Like Bomb Squad was one thing had, but these big boom bap loops that like Chemical Brothers and Prodigy always had, and just the aggression. But the two production styles always seemed so similar to me.
Yeah, totally. Well, yeah, there's many interviews where they say that's what they're influenced by completely.
Yeah.
That's what they were trying to do initially, is like combine hip hop and electronic music.
Yeah, and you can totally hear it. I mean, I don't know if we could hear it so much back then. You can definitely hear it in retrospect now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And what's interesting also is that's Noel Gallagher of Oasis singing, and he basically just sung parts of the Coming On Strong track, and I'm guessing maybe they sampled it first and they said, hey, why don't you just come in the studio and sing it?
Yeah, that might have been how it happened.
Who knows?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, there it is, Chemical Brothers, Setting Sun. All right, next up, same year, 1996, we got Rage Against the Machine, Bulls on Parade, here on the red vinyl 45. And I believe this is an original copy here, but let's check this out. All right, so you're saying earlier this is 96, same year as Chemical Brothers' Setting Sun. I mean, how did you discover this? Were you hearing this as a kid? Or?
Yeah, I was hearing this as a kid. My friend in school showed me this when I went over to his house, and yeah, it changed my life forever.
Yeah.
I'd never heard anything like this before. So again, it's just like the perfect marriage of like rock and rap. I could have chosen the obvious other tracks by Rage Against the Machine, but I felt like this one had a bigger impact on me. I think it had just more raw hitting energy. And yeah.
Yeah, I was reading up on this song. I mean, I remember when it came out. I think it was the Evil Empire album, but you know, someone from the band, I can't remember if it was Morello or someone else, but I want to read you this quote. He said, "The wall that Germany fell and the U.S. government was busy building another one between the border of U.S. and Mexico. Since 1986, as a result, a lot of the hate talk and hysteria that the government of the United States has been speaking, 1,500 bodies have been found on the border. We wrote this song in response to it." It's kind of interesting, like, you know, that obviously that's a huge, like, politically tinged topic. It's even still going on right now, but you know, they were obviously always super outspoken, and you know, they still are, you know.
Exactly. I mean, yeah, they really are like the pinnacle of that tradition of being political, and you know, since like Public Enemy and stuff.
Right.
They like, you know, they took that to the extreme. They did something really awesome.
You mentioned you had you said a friend. Did you have like that one friend in school that kind of would bring you records? Of, hey, listen to this. Hey, listen. Okay.
Yeah, I had that one friend.
Was it? Did he like work for a radio station, or he just, you know, he's the one that got all the albums or something?
I was six. No. Yeah, he just had an older brother. You know how it is.
Right.
Yeah, the older.
That's
sibling,
what I was looking
always.
For right there.
Yeah. And anything I didn't. Brother. Yeah, anything I didn't find out from him, I learned from my older brothers, who were more into like grunge and, you know, metal kind of stuff.
Sure.
So at 6 years old, you were really listening to stuff.
Yeah, I mean, nice. I was lucky. I came from like an artistic household, and like people in the school that I went to were also pretty like bohemian types. So yeah.
That's awesome.
I was really lucky.
Awesome.
So yeah, and you mentioned Public Enemy. I know you got to work with Chuck D in some capacity. I mean, maybe it was a sample, or I don't know if it was a redone vocal, but yeah, just while we're on the topic, I mean, tell us about why it was important for you to get Chuck. You know, we're huge PE fans over here.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, that was awesome. I mean, I'd never imagined that I could get him on a track, but yeah, it was originally a sample, and then he was kind enough to redo it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
I got to meet him once, but most of the process was done remotely. But yeah, I got to hang out with him at his show in London. Yeah, he was really cool.
Yeah.
And the show was awesome. Yeah, it was incredible to be able to work with such a legend, obviously.
Yeah, totally. He's amazing. Yeah, Public Enemy. Yeah, and also, while we're on the topic, I also wanted to bring up, are you familiar with the Denzel Curry cover, 2020 cover of Bulls on Parade?
Oh, yeah. I saw it.
Yeah.
It's really good, actually.
Yeah, it is great.
Yeah.
You know?
It's easy to ruin that song, and you didn't, so.
Yeah,
big up.
Yep, 100%.
Think about the balls you had to have to cover it. Like, I
right. You have to have balls to cover it.
You have to have balls. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, there it is. Rage Against the Machine, Bulls on Parade. All right, next up, right around the same time, 1994, you got Soundgarden, Black Hole Sun. Here we got the picture disc vinyl. And, man...
That had to be your brothers, right? Your brothers put you on this one.
Yep.
Yeah, see.
Exactly.
Yeah, so let's hope this plays at 45, because I got it on 45. But, man, this song's amazing. I mean, I actually got turned on to them around that time through Spoon Man, which is a cheesy song, you know. But then I got this album, and I heard this, and I was like, oh, my God, these guys are incredible, you know. But yeah,
the story of Spoon Man's, we can talk about Spoon Man another time, but it's an interesting story if you look it up. This song, obviously, it's just, I think it's
fast?
Playing it.
Yeah,
45 again.
Chris Cornell never got that high.
I can't, it's a little harder for me
could've.
To hear the audio here.
She tried.
So go ahead.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Black Hole Sun, obviously probably one of Soundgarden's biggest tracks, for a reason, I think, because it's like one of the most beautiful songs ever written, I think, regardless of genre. You know, it rivals all classical music and all jazz, and you know, it has such deeply musical complexity, but yet it's so catchy and not like it doesn't, it's not taxing. It's just a perfect, it's like the perfect song, I think.
It really is. I mean, and you know, it's what's also great is the juxtaposition, because they got kind of this like almost like Hawaiian surf guitar type sound in the beginning, and then like they come with the harder like grunge sounds, and
yeah, everything from the instrumentation, the lyrics, the, you know, it's just the perfect 10.
You mentioned with your musical background, so when you first heard this song, did you hear all the complexities of everything, or later on in life were you able to pick out different?
Yeah, I think it's more like appreciating it more as you get older, but yeah, even as a kid hearing it, it still had a huge impact, and I know it did for a lot of people, so it's expected.
Yeah, how about the music video with like the distorted faces and yeah,
exactly, it says so much without saying anything really.
right
Yeah, and seeing that as a kid obviously you know,
freaked you out.
It freaked me out. I kind of understood it so much because I grew up in like suburban Cleveland, so
okay.
I empathize with that staleness he was trying to communicate.
Totally. Like, it was kind of making fun of that, like, kind of 1950s, like, view of, like, Americana, like, Leave It to Beaver-ish, and then kind of just melting it and distorting it and, like, you know, really good
exactly.
stuff. And rest in peace to Chris Cornell.
Yeah, all definitely. Right.
There it is, Soundgarden, Black Hole Sun. All right, Matt, next up on your list here is an incredible album, Radiohead, Kid A, and your cut here is How to Disappear Completely. Man, I remember when this came out, and, you know, I was more of a hip-hop head at that time, but I listened to Radiohead, and that's probably pretty much true for every hip-hop head in that era.
Yeah.
You know, but, like, I like this better than OK Computer because I was like, oh, okay, they got rid of the hard guitars. This is a little more my steez, you know what I mean? But I remember people were not initially feeling Kid A because they were like, you know, and then, of course, everyone came around to it. But tell us about your experience here with your exposure.
Well, yeah, I immediately loved Kid A when I first heard it. I think, yeah, because I was already starting to love electronic music, and I already loved Radiohead from OK Computer.
Sure.
Hearing this was just like, you know, obviously a perfect marriage of everything I'd been loving up to that point. So,
yeah,
and this track in particular, I think, had the most musical impact on me because of just the way that there's this atonal drone happening in the background constantly, you know, over this very melodic, it adds this tension into the track that I try and put into everything I do now. So yeah, just this one track had a huge impact, but obviously the whole album from beginning to end is amazing. But, yeah,
it really is. And you know, this album is, it's almost like, in my mind, like one long piece of music because it's so cohesive. Like, you know, a lot of times you hear albums, especially in more modern times when you know, and Radiohead never did this, but a lot of, you know, groups now, especially in different genres, will, like, it'll be packed with collaborations and guest appearances, and then we start to get away from the sound of the band, you know what I mean? And this is just a perfect, like, you know, cinema that just plays all the way through, and you want to digest the whole thing, you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
I think I'm the only one that likes the album, their first album. Versus,
oh, really?
Yeah. I remember the interview we had with Little Brother, and, you know, Fonte picked this, and I was just like, yeah, I like the first. And I think it's because of the guitars. I like the hard.
Yeah.
You know, I was all about parties back then, so I wanted hard aggression, like, you know.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah. There's two types of Radiohead fans. There's the, the Pablo Honey and Kid A fans.
Yep. All right. There it is. Radiohead, How to Disappear Completely.
global controls will have to be imposed, and a world governing body will be created to enforce them.
All right, next up we got Deltron 3030 here on the purple vinyl. This is a record that's right in the era of hiphopsite.com, which Warren
this
and
is
I
a Pizzo record right
yeah
here.
We used to run
was, yeah
and shout out to Dell. We had Dell on the show
really?
A year ago.
Yeah
but yeah, tell us about Virus and Dan the Automator and all this great stuff.
Well, I only really started properly getting into hip hop in like the early thousands, mid thousands. And yeah, this was one of the albums that I first fell in love with hip hop too, because it was just so weird. The production was just so out there, and yeah, it's like a psychedelic album in hip hop. We're in the first, and then you know, I got into like Quasimodo and stuff like that, and Madlib stuff, and because I like that like weird stuff, and this was like one of the first albums that got me into that. So, especially this track,
Yeah, it's just amazing. And you know what's crazy is like, you know, I just brought it just in case this got brought up, but Dr. Octagon, I don't know if you're ever into this. Go ahead.
I'd only gotten into that like afterwards, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so Dan the Automator produced this and Deltron 3030. And like, this was kind of like a bridge into Gorillaz, because Dan did the production on the first Gorillaz album before Danger Mouse came in. And you know, Dell was all over that record too, you know what I mean? So, but really, when you talk about, you know, obviously there's Blur, but the other half of that, at that beginning stage of Gorillaz, was Dan the Automator and to some extent Dell, you know what I mean? So pretty amazing that all these things kind of came out of this, you know.
Exactly.
Were you more attracted to the how do I say this right, the backpack underground hip hop versus like, you know, Dell's albums on Elektra? Like,
yeah, exactly. I was more into the weird, obscure
the weird
stuff.
Okay, I didn't want to say weird, but since you said weird. Yeah. And again, I mean, like Pizzo was saying, was like, this is huge for us on Hip Hop Site, like this whole vein was huge for us, and that's probably what we made the bulk of our business from,
right?
So yeah, after the call, you guys should talk, because Pizzo could probably give you a whole list of stuff you might have missed.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. Because I only skimmed the surface, and I'm still searching, so.
Yeah.
You know, it's also interesting that you mentioned like the psychedelic sound, because one of the records that Dell picked when we had him on the show was Frank Zappa.
Oh yeah.
You know what I mean? And so like, you know, it really fits, you know, that his tastes, you know, in like that 60s psychedelica come through in his like 90s and early 2000s hip hop, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, I can totally hear that.
Yeah, 100%. All right, there it is. Deltron 3030, Virus. All right, next up, kind of in the same vein as Deltron 3030 with like the kind of very underground hip hop super group, but Madlib and MF Doom, Madvillain, and this is the new vinyl. Turntable Lab just released this as like a part of this crazy Stone's Throw box set of like all their like classic albums.
Nice.
And your cut on here is Figaro. All right, so your cut on here is Figaro, and when we had rapper Afro on the show, he picked Rhinestone Cowboy from this record, and Doom is like one of the most frequently picked artists on the show. Like, it's you know, everyone loves Doom, and he's kind of left out of those, you know, who's the greatest rapper of all time conversations, but I think there's a ton of people who would absolutely have him in their top five list, you know. So tell us about Madlib, MF Doom, Figaro, Madvillain, etc.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a bigger Madlib fan than I am a MF Doom fan, but he is still one of the greatest rappers of all time. But I honestly think Madlib is one of the greatest is probably the greatest hip hop producer of all time. I like him more than Dilla, and he's just he does everything so well, like from you know this like boom bappy kind of hip hop thing swing or if it's jazz or I love Madlib. So this is a perfect example of why I love him. This beat is just like perfectly produced, and obviously MF Doom makes it amazing. That whole album is one of the best produced albums of all time.
I'm curious, with your musical background and you know, everything, so you love Madlib. Is it the way he puts, like, what is it about his production that it so intrigues you? Because I mean, that's a pretty heavy statement you'd made.
Yeah, I think it's because it's wrong. It's always wrong,
right?
It's so right. Every time he just chooses the most wrong ideas, but they always work somehow. So I think that it's magic. That's the magic of his production.
And when you say wrong, like the keys, the notes, or the way it's looped, or
exactly. It's just off. It's just a little bit off, but it's like so right. You couldn't be any other way. You know, it's like he found the perfect imperfection.
Yeah, and it also, like, you know, it was also kind of the antithesis of what was happening in hip-hop at that time. So, like, in, you know, 2004 when this came out, hip-hop got super clean. Like, the big record was, like, in the club, 50 Cent. A Dr. Dre beat that is, like, mixed to perfection, and you can hear every little, you know, and it's clean. This is dirty as it gets, you know. Like, I remember when it first came out, you know, someone had said to me, like, oh, it sounds like he recorded that album inside of an armpit. And I was just like, yeah, exactly. It's incredible. And the first time I heard the album, I didn't get it, and I kept listening because I was reviewing a lot of records back then, and I listened to it more and more and more, and I was like, this is incredible. Like, this is amazing, but you have to understand it, and you can't really grasp it on that first listen, you know.
I've never heard anyone explain the production of Madlib the way you did, Madlib. I mean, I really, you know, thank you for that, because that makes a lot of sense. A lot of people have, when the Rise of the Wu-Tang had said a similar thing with RZA. Mm-hmm. Do you hear that with RZA stuff too? Okay,
totally. Yeah, with RZA, it's way more raw and like just unrefined. And,
And just Madlib. Off.
Yeah, that offness is there. But yeah, Madlib just takes that and then just like turns it into this Mona Lisa kind of, like,
all right.
Where it's like, RZA's like hard, dirty, like, you know, it's like the punk of hip hop, I feel like. But Madlib is just like crazy. I don't know how else to explain it.
Yeah, all right. Well, there it is. Madvillain Figaro. Okay, not an original copy, but we have the Guardians of the Galaxy soundtrack here. And I don't know if you know which cut you picked from this. Do you know?
No, what's on the Guardians?
The song is 10cc, I'm Not In Love.
Yeah.
That's one of my perfect bands. Mm-hmm. I love that band.
10cc? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Love. This song is incredible.
Yeah, I like this song because it's just so different from the rest of their other songs, and it was experimental in like its production. The way they did that like vocal pad thing in the background, it's like they had loops of tape and they all sang one note into these loops, and they had different they all sent the different notes to different channels on their console, and they would all just play them. And I think that's one of the coolest things ever,
right?
Like hearing how they did that.
Well, and it's also, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, it's all right. Carry on.
No, I was just gonna say it was super innovative at the time, because no one was really doing stuff like that back then. Like now, to, you know, track, sample your own voice and track it and play it is, you know, people, I mean, look at all those great records like Major Lazer, Lean On, that play with the vocal as a hook, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But this was way ahead. Like, no one's doing that back then.
Was the attraction to this, record to me was, I, like we were saying about Black Hole Sun, I thought this was one of the most perfect songs ever. I thought the vocal, the momentum in the song, how it, you know, the key, the how it sonically sounded, it still stands up to me like to everything else. But your attraction to this song, was it the production style or was it the songwriting? Or
yeah, obviously the song is amazing. But that especially that pad, I don't know what it is about that vocal pad. It's been sampled so many times by all my favorite artists, and I've tried to recreate it so many times. And yeah, obviously the song is beautiful, but as from a production standpoint, it's had a huge impact on me. Just the sonics of it.
Yeah.
It was huge. It was groundbreaking for the time, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So you said, mentioned that earlier about Radiohead, and how like the, you know, some of those little pieces in the background that you try to emulate in your own thing. And you're saying that that's kind of true for this as well in terms of.
Exactly. Like if this was just a song that had a nice little bossa nova beat in a, and some electronic piano chords, it wouldn't be as rich. Is that vocal pad in the background is really what makes it, I feel like. It gives it that depth and that beauty. And yeah, if you watch the 10cc documentary, they talk about how it was originally just a kind of standard bossa nova pop song, and then they like stripped it down and then put that pad in, and it just became this magic thing. To think to do that even at the time was incredible.
Really kind of, you know, I love it when, you know, when we had Flostradamus, Kurt from Flostradamus on the show, he was, a lot of the records that he picked were like people using technology in ways they weren't supposed to. So like I remember he really liked how like Primus was, you know, using what he said was Mixmaster Mike was using a wah-wah pedal with scratching, so it would create this weird effect, and like that's not what that's for,
right?
But you know, they found a way to use it, so it seems like you're kind of appreciating that, you know, that method of kind of breaking something that, you know, or using something that in a way that is innovative, not really what it's meant for.
Exactly.
And I'll just add one more thing. You said a lot of your favorite artists sampled this. Did you know Madlib sampled it?
Really?
Yeah.
What track?
It's on the Freddie Gibbs album, the Pinata album.
Oh yeah.
There's like a little sketch, and there's, you know, so.
There you go. Yeah, it's probably one of the most sampled tracks of all time. This.
Yeah.
Just that pad.
Yeah.
I wonder which part you sampled. I'll have to go check.
Yeah. All right. There it is. 10cc. I'm Not in Love. All right, next up, another heavily picked album for the show, which is the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds.
Oh.
And here we have this crazy multicolor yellow and green vinyl. And your song on here is Don't Talk. Let's put your head on my shoulder.
Yeah, this one's definitely my favorite, though.
Okay. So I can't really hear it. Is that the right track?
Yep.
Okay. So tell us about Don't Talk. I know, I mean, I remember Nicolay picked I Just Wasn't Made for These Times when we had him, but... why this album, etc.
This album is probably one of the greatest albums of all time, and many people would agree, but this is my favorite song on the album because I don't know, it's hard to explain why this is my favorite song, but it's, I think musically it's just really interesting. First of all, the chord structure is very unique. And I don't know how to explain why I love this song so much. It's just so good. I don't know. I think Paul McCartney said it was like the perfect song ever.
I think you kind of hit on it. It's like when you mentioned the chord structure, it's like it's such a pull with Brian's voice, and it's just like it's almost like a battle. Like they're. I don't know. It's like, I almost want to like grab a pitch control and kind of like put it right or something. Like it's such a pull, you know?
Right, right.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's that thing of being wrong, but being so right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. What it, so they say, like, in chord structure, you hit, like, is it the fifth, and then you say the fifth, and the fifth pulls you back to the root note or something like that. It's like, it's like the whole song is on the fifth, and I just want to be pulled back to the
right.
But it's not. It is the root. Like, it, yeah, I definitely hear that.
Yeah, and it creates this, like, longing, and it's just such an emotional song. You know, yeah, the lyrics and everything is just, the music really brings that out.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also, like, you know, if you look at some of your other cuts here, it's a vibe in the same vein as, like, the 10cc I'm Not in Love, or like the Radiohead, you know, just that kind of very, like, kind of minimalist, you know, not heavy drums, you know, kind of chilled out,
moody.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff like that. Yeah. It's like either that or angry or
right. Rage or 10cc.
Yeah. Not much in between.
Yeah.
All right, there it is. Beach Boys, Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder. I've got the All right. Can't have a show without a Soul 45. And we have Irma Thomas, Zero it's Willpower. I don't really know this song, so you're gonna have to educate me on this. What can you tell us about this 1979?
Well, I could have chosen any Irma Thomas song, but this one's been covered so many times by, like, smaller artists, and it's just a underappreciated song by a very underappreciated artist that I feel like needs to be highlighted. She's probably my favorite soul singer of all time, because there's something dark about her music. It's so, like, it's soulful, but it's also kind of like, there's something really tragic and dark, and it appeals to the Radiohead somber side of
me. For sure.
This is a perfect example of that. You know, it's a soulful ballad about how weak she is as a person, and, you know, how it's called Zero Willpower, like,
right.
But a lot of her music is like that. It's just so it's dark.
Who put that. You on to her?
A TV show.
Oh, okay.
So Black Mirror, when I first saw it in, like, 2010, one of the episodes had an Irma Thomas song, so I was like, who the hell's this? And I had to look it up and found this huge back catalog of stuff. And yeah, she's still around today and still going. And she definitely needs more recognition, I think. Because, really amazing singer and songwriter.
Nice. All right. Well, there it is. Nice. Shout out Irma Thomas.
And Black Mirror.
Yeah, Black Mirror. A little Black Mirror goes a long way, though.
Oh,
yeah. You should watch one episode, you're like, all right.
Exactly. Okay. But it's telling, you know, that Black Mirror used Irma Thomas.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. She's just a bit dark.
Yeah. Bright. All right, there it is. Irma Thomas, Zero Willpower. All right, Matt, now we got your new album here, Illusion of Depth, which is here on vinyl, which is great. Love it that you can hold it in your hand, but it's also on your digital platforms.
Yep.
And we got the single here, Colors, which is in heavy rotation on Diplo's Revolution on Sirius XM. And so I was just saying earlier in the break, you know, your album is varied. It has, like, a lot of different styles and, you know, different types of songs. But this is your, like, kind of forward-facing single. And, you know, we were talking about this with Cut Copy a little bit when we had them on the show, but, you know, what's the role of the club banger, you know, the dance song when we're in a pandemic and we can't celebrate, right?
Yeah, it's hard to say, really. When I made this album, it was meant to be, like, the first time I really focused on the live aspect of my music. Because before, when I made albums, I just kind of imagined, like, it's like a soundtrack to something, and I'll fit it into my set somehow.
Yeah.
This one was specifically made to go on tour with and have a visual experience with. So yeah, the pandemic coming right as the album dropped kind of it's hard to say what the role is, but now I'm doing like virtual events with like time-coded visuals and stuff, so I managed to find a way to make it make sense. But yeah, I don't feel like this is like a pure banger. It's definitely got radio quality to it, right. I guess, if you could say that. But everything on this album, I tried to make it fit in a live context, but also be more like just a song you would listen to.
Yeah. Day to day. No, I love this. This track is so good. I mean, it's kind of like a little bit of a disco house banger, you know, and like, it's just, I love that style. I've always loved that style. I've always been attracted to that, like, you know, kind of disco sample or filtering kind of thing. You know
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
And then just so like danceable and
it's kind of like
fun
like new disco, kind of a real good new disco feel. But it's still a banger. Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not the big EDC drop, you know, thing. It's a danceable banger. You know.
Yeah.
So,
I was more inspired by like Chemical Brothers, Star Guitar, like kind of stuff. Than like modern dance bangers. I think that's
true.
And then just because all my production experience has been in like EDM, I just couldn't help but make it sound like that. But I was going for something a little bit more classic sounding.
Yeah, no, you did a great job. It's an excellent track. And what else do you want to say about this album here? I mean, it's your third record, right?
Yeah, it was a wild 3 years making the album. If you check out the track Paralysis, I tried to impart some of that weird atonal pad quality of some of the tracks I was talking about.
You sample Tim CC?
I didn't sample. Oh, I actually, I got a vocalist to record a bunch of notes, and I did it
nice.
So, but yeah. The whole album's pretty varied, but it's probably the most cohesive album I've ever done because it's all around the same tempo.
Right.
It's all very different musically.
Yeah, yeah. Are there other songs that you picked here today that you see that, you know, kind of direct line to on this album, like you just mentioned?
Yeah, definitely. Well, Setting Sun, you can hear all over like tracks like Bruxism. And let's see what else. I mean, yeah, it's all the whole album is just a mishmash of everything I've grown up with. So you'll hear all those qualities. At least I hope so.
Yeah.
I tried to, making things wrong nowadays is actually really hard because you have, you know, quantized audio and everything can be perfect. So most people just make it perfect.
Right.
And you have to try almost to make things wrong nowadays. So I tried to do things a little bit more wrong and, yeah, impart that kind of Mad Lib wrongness into it. But still came out sounding pretty clean, I think.
Where do you feel where do you feel dance music, or just your comment on dance music from where it was, you know, with like the Porter Robinson Easy, or, you know, you and Porter Easy, to now? Like, where do you see, like, how has it matured in your eyes?
Well, yeah, people are less afraid to be experimental, I think, nowadays. Especially now that club shows and festivals are pretty much not happening. People are forced to listen to music more, which just, you know, obviously makes people produce different types of music. Bangers are less common now because nobody, you know, it doesn't feel relevant in context to what's happening.
Right.
So, yeah.
It's like, put your fucking mask on.
Yeah. And I wonder, after the worst of the pandemic is over, I wonder how music will have changed by then, and will it have an impact on live music after that?
Sure.
One of the things I was talking to a few friends of mine, and we were talking about the acceptance of a Zoom party or a Twitch party. And I've turned a lot of people on to different DJs that are on Twitch. And I'm like, imagine when this whole thing's over, like Twitch and its elements will still be there. Do you really want to go to a club and stand up and be squashed and, you know, rubbing against smelly people when you could just invite, say, 30 people to your house or, you know, and, you know, it costs like a tenth of the, you know, cost and, you know, you can cuddle up in different corners and you just have the TV on and maybe tip the guy, like, you know?
Yeah, I think there definitely will be more virtual events in the, like, even after the pandemic. Like, people will still think, oh, this that was actually really great. I prefer that. But I still think there's going to be loads of people who are,
I agree with
who
you
miss the sweaty, you know, sticky floors and drinks.
Oh, no. I mean, we're probably headed towards a baby boom when you think about it.
Yeah, I agree there.
You know, I mean, the single scene, I mean, I can't imagine being single right now, like, and trying to, you'd be miserable, like, trying to, you can't go to a club, you can't, you know. So I imagine that the next thing that we'll see when everybody's healthy, it's like a lot of kids being born, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So
definitely. I just think that the pandemic has made, like I was talking about music with lanes, I think the pandemic has brought up a whole nother lane that's acceptable to party on Zoom. I mentioned my buddy Chris Coxkin, he did a virtual Halloween party, and I remember he was talking about it. He was going to different places doing it on his during his Twitch stream, and I remember him talking about it. I'm thinking, dude, this is not going to work, this is not going to look good. And I remember tuning into it during the Halloween costume contest. And I was like, wow, this actually works. So I think we're just carving, like Matt, like you said, I think we're everyone's going to want to go back. A lot of people are going to want to go back to how it was and have parties and, you know, all that stuff. But I think that this pandemic is definitely carving a lane that you can do all this virtual also.
Well, it just forced us to embrace technology that we might have not been embracing before, such as like StreamYard or Zoom, you know what I mean? Like, stuff you were like, oh yeah, you can do that, but I don't use that.
Right.
And it's like, well, now you have to know how to use that.
Right.
And, you know, now it's changing our behaviors and habits, you know.
Now Boiler Room makes a lot more sense.
Right. Yeah. All right, that is it. This is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
Today's special guest, Matt Zoe, the new album, Illusion of Depth. Go get this. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, great picks, great selections, and
awesome selection, man.
Yeah,
great,
wonderful picks. Album.
For real.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks again. All right, we're out of here.
Peace.
See ya.